As you can tell, our cast is very excited tonight. Tonight is our closing show, and we are very excited to perform it for you. We will be doing The Importance of Being Earnest by Oscar Wilde, his 1895 play. It is a three-act play, and it runs just under about 2 hours, and we will have one intermission right in the middle of Act Two, about 10 minutes. At that time, please feel free to use the restrooms in the lobby, and concessions are also available for purchase. And lastly, please make sure that your cell phones are silenced and that you do not use flash photography. Thank you very much and enjoy the show.
Mr. Ernest Worthing.
How are you, my dear Ernest? What brings you up to town?
Pleasure. What else will bring one anyway? Eating as usual, I see, Algy?
I believe it's customary good sight to have some such pleasures at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
In the country.
What on earth do you do there?
When one's in town, one needs with oneself. When one's in the country, one needs with other people. It's excessively boring.
And who are the people you meet?
Oh, neighbors.
Got nice neighbors in your part of Shropshire.
Perfectly horrid. Never speak to one of them.
How immensely you must amuse them. By the way, Shropshire is a county, is it not?
Shropshire? Yes, of course. Hello, why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young who's coming to tea?
Many other guests that end go anyway.
How perfectly delightful.
Yes, it is all very well. But I'm afraid I'm supposed to walk quite approve of you being here.
May I ask why?
My dear boy, the way you go to Gwen is perfectly disgraceful. It's almost as bad as the way she flirts with you.
I'm in love with Gwen. I've come up to town expressively to propose to her.
I thought you had come up for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are.
There's nothing romantic about a definite proposal. It's very nice to be in love, but the very essence of love is uncertain. If I ever get married, I will certainly try to forget the fact.
Well, I have no doubt about that, dear Alan. A divorce court was especially invented for people whose memories are so curiously constituted.
There's no speculating upon that subject. Divorce is a made in heaven. Please, don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They are ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
You've been eating them all the time.
That is quite a different matter. She is my aunt. Have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is for Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn is devoted to bread and butter.
Very good bread and butter, isn't it?
My dear boy, you need not eat as if you're going to eat at all. You behave as if you are married to her already. You are not married to Gwendolyn already. And I don't think you ever will be.
Why don't you say that?
In the first place, girls never marry a Nicola. Girls are right.
Nonsense.
It isn't. It accounts for an extraordinary number of bachelors that one sees all over the place. In the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
My dear boy, Gwendolyn is my first cousin. And before I allow you to marry her, you have to clear up the whole question of Cecily.
No, Cecily? What on earth do you mean? What do you mean I'm to buy Cecily? I don't know anyone with the name of Cecily.
Bring me that secret case Mr. Warden left in this moment from the last time he died here.
Yes, sir.
You mean to say you've had my secret case all this time? Well, I wish to goodness you let me know. I'm writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. Very nearly offered the large reward.
Well, I wish you would offer one. I have been more than usually hard up.
That's no good offering the large reward now that the thing is found.
That is rather mean of you, I must say. However, it makes no matter, for now that I look at the inscription inside, I find the thing is yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times, and you have no right whatsoever to read what's written inside. It's a very ungentlemanly thing to read one's private cigarette case.
Oh, it's absurd to have a hard and fast rule what one should and what one shouldn't read. More than half of modern culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
I'm quite aware of that, and I don't propose to speak of modern culture. What is the sort of thing one should talk about in private? I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case was a printed from someone of the name of Cecily, and you said you didn't know your last name.
Well, you really want to know. Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes, charming old lady she is too. Lives at Tunbridge Wells. Just give it back to me, Archie.
Yes, but why did your aunt, who lives at Tunbridge Wells, cause you her uncle? For little Cecily was her fondest love to her dear uncle, Jack.
My dear fellow, what on earth is that now? Some aunts are tall, some aunts are not tall. Surely a matter that an aunt may be allowed to decide for herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be exactly like your own. Well, that's absurd. Then say, keep it back to me, Archie.
Yes, why did your aunt, who lives in Cambridge Wells, pass her uncle? There is no objection, I admit, to an aunt being small. But why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, shall call her own nephew her uncle? I can't quite make it out. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It is Ernest.
It isn't Ernest, it's Jack.
You have always told me it was Ernest. I have introduced you to everyone as Ernest. You look as if your name was Ernest. You are the most earnest looking person I've ever saw in my life. It's absurd you saying your name isn't Ernest. It's on your card. Here's one of them. Mr. Ernest Worthing, before the Albany. I'll keep this a secret that your name is Ernest, in case you ever try to deny it to me, to Gwendolyn, or to anyone else.
Ernest in town and Jack in the country, and the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, that does not account that I your aunt called you her dear uncle. Come on, boy, you better have the thing up at once.
My dear aunt, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It's very vulgar for one to talk like a dentist when one isn't a dentist. Reduces the false impression.
That is what dentists always do. Now go on, tell me the whole thing. I may mention that I've always suspected you of being a confirmed ticket fundraiser. I'm quite sure I'm taking it out.
Fundraiser? What on earth is fundraiser?
I'll reveal to you that incomparable expression as soon as you are kind enough to tell me why you are Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Here's my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation and pray make it improbable.
My dear fellow, nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, perfectly ordinary. Late Mr. Thomas Garton, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Garton. Cecily, who addressed me as her uncle from motives of respect that you could never possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
And where is that place in the country, by the way?
Well, that's nothing to you, dear boy. You're not going to be invited. I may tell you quite candidly that the place is not in Shropshire.
Oh, I should sit for that, my dear friend. I have been all over Shropshire. On 2 separate occasions. Now go on. Why are you Ernest and Sam and Jack in the country?
My dear aunt, I don't know whether you'll be serious enough to understand. When one is placed in the position of God, and has to adopt a very high moral tone in all subjects, when duty to do so, in order to get up to town, I always pretended to have a younger brother of the name of Ernest, who lives up the Albany and gets into most dreadful scripts. That, my dear aunt, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is rarely pure and never simple. What you really are is a Bunbury's. I was right in saying you were. You are one of the most advanced Bunbury's I know.
What on earth do you mean?
You have invented a younger brother called Ernest, so that you might have the pleasure of going up to town as much as you like. I have invented an invaluable pundit called Bunbury. Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. Why, if it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, for instance, I wouldn't have the pleasure of dining with you tonight at Willis's, for I have been really engaged to go for more than a week.
Well, I hadn't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You are absurd about sending out invitations. Nothing annoys me more as not receiving invitations.
You know, you've much better time than you want to discuss them.
I have no intention of any kind. To begin with, I dine there on Monday. And dining one with one's relations is quite enough. In the second place, whenever I do dine there, I am treated as a member of the family and sent down with no woman at all, or two. In the third place, I know perfectly well who she'll place me next to tonight. She'll place me next to Mary Farquhar, who always flirts with her own husband of quasi-dignity. It's not very pleasant. Indeed, it's not even decent. And that sort of thing is on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husband is perfectly scandalous. It's like washing one's clean linen in public. Besides, never to know you to become a confirmed Bunbury's. I actually want to talk to you about Bunbury. I want to know your rules.
I'm not a Bunbury's at all. If one doesn't accept me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I'll kill him in any case. Cecily's a little too much interested in him. He's rather bored. So I'm going to get rid of her. And I strongly advise you to do the same with Mr. With your invalid friend by that absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to talk with Bunbury. And if you ever get married, which seems extremely problematic, you will be glad to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
That's nonsense. I marry a charming girl like Bunbury, and she's the only girl I've ever cared for in my life. Certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. You don't seem to realize that in married life, three is company and two is none. That must be interesting. If I can distract her for about 10 minutes, so that she might have the pleasure of proposing to Gwendolyn, will you dine with me tonight at Willis's?
Yes, if you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about meals. It's so shallow, sir.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Woo! Oh, dear Andrew, I hope you are behaving very well.
I'm feeling very well, Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
Me? You are smart.
I am always smart. Am I not, Mr. Worthing?
You're quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I am not that. It will leave no room for development, and I intend to develop in many directions. I'm sorry for your little late outlook, but I was obliged to call on dear Lady Halbury. I hadn't been there since her poor husband's death. I never saw a woman so altered. She seemed quite 20 years younger. And now I'll recover to eat one of those nice cucumber sandwiches you promised me.
Certainly, Augusta.
Won't you come sit over here, Gwendolyn? Oh, no thanks for mine. How comfortable where I am.
Good heavens, Lane! Why are there no cucumber sandwiches? I ordered them especially.
There were no cucumbers in the market this morning, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for any money.
That will do, Lane. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm really distressed, Augusta, about there being no cucumber sandwiches. Not even for ready money.
It really makes no matter, Algernon. I had some crumpets with Lady Halbury. Oh, seems to be living entirely for pleasure now.
I hear her hair has turned quite gold from grief.
It certainly has changed its colour. From what cause, I of course cannot say. Quite a treat for you tonight, Algernon. I'm going to send you down with Mary Farquhar. She is such a nice woman. So
to give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight after all.
I hope not, Algernon. Put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he is accustomed to that.
It is a great hall, but I need hardly say a great disappointment. But I have just had a telegram saying my poor friend Bunbury is sick again, and they think I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury, a dreadful invalid.
Well, I must say, Algernon, that I think that it is a high time that Mr. Bunbury and Edith's mind either going to live or die. This shin-shanging of the question is absurd. I should be much obliged if you were to ask Mr. Bunbury from me to be kind enough to have to not have relapses that day. For I rely on you to arrange my music. It is my last reception, and we want something that will encourage conversation, particularly at the end of the season, when everyone has said whatever it is they have to say. Which, in most cases, was probably not much.
I will speak to Bunbury after this, if he is still conscious. And I think I can promise you, he'll be okay by Saturday. You see, the music is a great difficulty. If one plays good music, people don't listen. And if one plays bad music, people don't talk. But if you'll kindly come to the next gym with me, I will go to the program I have just written out.
Thank you, Algernon. I'm sure the program will be delightful. Gwendolyn, you will accompany me.
Straight to Mama.
Charming days in this bathhouse.
Hey, do not talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else, and that makes me so nervous.
I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I am never wrong.
I would like to be allowed to take advantage of Lady Brockham's temporary absence.
Oh, it took me a while. while I am making these inquiries, you, Gwendolyn, will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama!
In the carriage, Gwendolyn!
Between 7,000 and 8,000 a year.
In land or investments?
With investments chiefly. I have a country house, of course, with land attached to it. About 1,500 acres, I believe.
A country house? How many bedrooms? Well, that point can be cleared up afterwards. You have a townhouse, I hope. A girl with a simple, unspoiled nature like Gwendolyn could hardly be expected to reside in a country.
Well, I own a house in Belfair Square, but it's left by the year to Lady Blocktown. Of course, I can get it back whenever I'd like, at 6 months' notice.
No, I don't know her.
Oh, she goes about by a little lady considerably advanced in years.
Nowadays, it's no guarantee of respectability of character. What number in Belgrave Square?
149.
The unfashionable side. Something. However, that could easily be altered.
You mean fashionable side?
Both if necessary.
I'm afraid I really didn't kill my father. If I could think back, I'd say I'd lost my parents. But if you knew the truth to say my parents had lost me, you don't really know who I am by birth. I was, well, I was found.
Found?
Yes, the late Mr. Thomas Hardy, an old gentleman of very charitable and kind disposition, gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a first-class ticket for Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a place in Suffolk. It's a seaside resort.
Where did the charitable gentleman with the first-class ticket for this seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, Lady Bracknell, I was in a handbag. Somewhat large, brown leather handbag with handles to it. Ordinary handbag, in fact.
In what locality did this Mr. James or Thomas Cardew come across this ordinary handbag?
In the cloakroom at Victoria Station. Was given to him in for his own.
The cloak at Victoria Station.
Yes, the Brighton line.
The line is immaterial, Mr. Worthing. I must say I feel somewhat bewildered by what you have just told me. To be born, or at any rate, bred in a handbag, whether it had handles or not, seems to me to display a contempt for the ordinary decencies of family life.
May I ask you then, what would you advise me to do? I mean, hardly say I would do anything in the world to ensure Gwendolyn's happiness.
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to try and acquire some relation as soon as possible, and to make a definite effort to produce one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
I don't see how I can possibly do that. I can produce a handbag, I think. You really think that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell?
Yes, sir! What has this to do with me? You can hardly imagine that I, Lord Bracknell, would dream of allowing our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a handbag. Good morning, Mr. Wells.
they are engaged. Her mother is purposely unbearable. Never met such a Gorgon. I mean, I don't really know what a Gorgon's like, but I'm quite sure that he grapples one. And in any case, she's a monster. Not being a myth, this is quite a fact. Well, I'm sorry, I suppose I shouldn't be speaking of your aunt in that way before you.
My dear boy, I love hearing my relations with you. It is the only thing that makes me put up with them at all. Listen to us simply a pretty sack of people who have the remotest knowledge how to live, nor the smallest inkling about what to die.
That's nonsense.
It isn't.
I'm not going to argue with you about that. You always want to argue about things.
Well, that's what things were originally made for.
Upon my word, if I caught that, I'd shoot myself. And there's any chance of one of them becoming my mother? About 150 years, do you, Algie?
Everyone will become back another. That's their turn. No man does. And that sense.
Is that clever?
It's perfectly phrased, as anything in civilized life should be.
I'm sick to death of clever. Everybody's clever nowadays. Can't go anywhere without meeting clever people. The thing has become an absolute nuisance. You know, I wish to goodness we had a few fools.
We have.
Well, I would extremely like to meet them. What do they talk about?
The fools? About the clever people, of course.
But what fools?
By the way, did you tell Gwendolyn yet about you being a companion jack in the country?
Oh, dear aunt. The truth isn't the sort of thing one does to a nice, a sweet, refined girl. Extraordinary ideas you have about the way to behave to her.
The only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her, if she is pretty, and someone else, if she is plain.
Nonsense.
What about your brother?
Before the end of the week, I shall have to get rid of him. I'll say he died in Paris, though. Apoplexy. Many people die of apoplexy. Quite suddenly, don't they?
Yes, but it is a hereditary. You are better off saying, severe chill.
You're sure severe chill isn't hereditary or anything like that?
Of course it isn't.
Well then, my poor brother Ernst, he carried off in Paris by severe chill. That gets rid of him.
But didn't you say Miss Carview was a little bit too much interested in your brother Ernst? Wouldn't you find it was a loss of a great deal?
Something isn't a silly romantic girl, I'm glad to say. Because a capital appetite goes long walks and pays no attention to his studies.
I would really like to see Cecily.
And I'll take very good care you never do. She's excessively pretty and she's only just 18.
Have you thought of Gwendolyn yet? You have an excessively pretty ward who's only just 18.
These aren't the sort of things one just blurts out upon in the public. Cecily and Gwendolyn are certainly extremely great friends. Bet you anything you know that half an hour after they've met will be calling to assist.
Girls will do that when they have to do for love other things first. Now, if you want to get a good thing about me, we really must go up and get dressed. Did you know it is nearly 7?
Oh, it's always nearly 7.
But I'm hungry.
I'll never eat anything worse.
So what shall we do after dinner? Go to the theater?
Oh, no, I love listening.
Well, can we go to the club?
Oh, no, I hate talking.
We can trot off around the egg hour and head.
Oh, no, I can't bear looking at things. It's quite silly.
Well, what shall we do?
Nothing.
It is awfully hard work to do nothing. However, I do love hard work, but there's no specific object of any kind.
Mrs. Fairfax!
Algy, climb it to your back now! I have something very particular to say to Mr. Woods.
Really, Gwendolyn? I don't think I can allow this at all.
Algy, you always adopt a strictly moral attitude for its life. You're not quite old enough to do that yet.
My own dog.
Ernest! We may never be married. From the expression of Mama's face, I fear we never shall. But although she may prevent us from becoming man and wife, I may marry someone else, and marry often, nothing that she can possibly do can alter my eternal devotion to you.
You Gwendolyn.
The story of your romantic origin, as related to me by Mama, with some pleasing comments, has naturally stirred the fibers of my nature. Your Christian name has an irresistible fascination. The simplicity of a character makes you exquisitely incomprehensible to me. Your town address at the Albany I have, what is the address in the country?
The Manor House, Wharton, Hertfordshire.
There is a good postal service, I suppose, and it would be necessary to do something drastic. That, of course, will require serious consideration. I will communicate with you daily.
My own one.
How long do you remain in town?
Till Monday.
Good. Algy, you may turn around now.
Thanks, I turn around already.
You may also ring the bell.
Starbucks, huh?
Yes, sir.
A glass of sherry, Lane.
Yes, sir.
Lane, tomorrow I'm going hungry. You can hang up all my smoking jackets, my dresses, and all the buggers.
Yes, sir.
I hope tomorrow will be a fine day, Lane.
It never is, sir.
Lane, you are a pessimist.
I do my best to give satisfaction, sir.
That is a sensible intellectual girl. The only girl I've ever cared for in all my life. What on earth are you so amused at?
Oh, a little anxious about poor Bunbury, that's all.
You'd better take care. Your friend Bunbury will get you into a serious scrape someday.
I love scrapes. They are the only thing that are never serious.
That's nonsense. No, you never told me anything but nonsense.
Nobody ever does.
Thank you.
process that you are not an attentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would pay upon her lips.
I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was drunk from beans. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from town yet.
Oh, we do not expect him until Monday afternoon.
I usually like to spend his Sundays in London. He's not one of those whose sole aim is enjoyment, as by all accounts that unfortunate young man his brother seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name is Letitia, Doctor.
A classical illusion, merely.
I shall see you both on that evening, song.
Wait! I find that I have a headache after all. And thank you. Might do it some good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We might go as far as the schools in
Bath.
That
would be the best. Cecily! You will read your political economy in my absence.
Horrid political economy.
A horrid geography.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, B for the Albany W. Uncle Jack's brother! Did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Yes, miss. He seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you were with him often ago. He said he was anxious to speak to you privately for a moment.
Pray ask him somehow. I suppose you'd better talk to the housekeeper about a room for him.
Yes, miss.
I have never met any really wicked person before. I feel rather frightened. I'm so afraid he will look just like anyone else. He does!
You are the doctor's necessity, I'm sure.
You must be under some strange mistake. I am not little. I am in fact more than unusually tall for my age. But I am your cousin Cecily. You, I see from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother. My cousin Ernest. My wicked cousin Ernest.
Oh, I'm not wicked at all, Cousin Cecily. You must think that I'm wicked.
If you were not, you surely have been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you have not been leading a double life. Pretending to be wicked and being really good all the time, that would be hypocrisy.
Oh, I have been rather reckless.
I am rather curious.
Now that you mention the subject, I have been very bad in my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that. Although I am sure it must have been very pleasant.
It is such a pleasure being here with you, Cousin Cecily.
I can't understand how you were even here at all. Uncle Jack will be back till Monday afternoon.
That is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to go by the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I am anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but in London?
No, the appointment is in London.
Well, I know, of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of the beauty in life. But I still think you had better wait till Uncle Jack arrives. I know he wants to speak to you about your immigrating.
About my what?
About your immigrating. He's gone out to buy you an outfit.
I certainly won't let Jack buy my outfit at all. He has no taste in neckties.
I don't think you will require neckties. Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'd sooner die.
Well, he said at dinner on Wednesday night that you had to choose between this world, the next, and Australia.
Well, the accounts I've received in Australia and the next world are not particularly encouraging. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid I'm not that. That is why I want you to reform me. You might make it your mission, if you don't mind, Cousin Cecily.
I'm afraid I have no time this afternoon.
Well, would you mind my reforming myself this afternoon?
I think it is quite quixotic of you, but I think you should try.
I will. I feel better already.
You are looking a little worse.
That is because I'm hungry.
Oh, how thoughtless of me. I should have remembered when one is leading an entirely new life, one requires regular
rose.
Why?
Because you are like a pink rose, Princess Lee.
I don't think it would be right for you to talk to me like that. Miss Prism never says such things to me.
Then Miss Prism is a short-sighted old lady. You are the beauty girl I want to
see. Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snare.
They are a snare that every sensible man would like to be caught in.
I wouldn't want to catch a sensible man. I shouldn't know what to talk to him about.
You are too much alone, dear Dr. Charsville. You should get married.
The primitive church was strictly against matrimony.
But that is why the primitive church has not lasted till present day. And you do not seem to realize that by remaining single, a man converts himself to permanent public temptation. This very celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
But is a man not equally attractive when married?
Oh, a man is ever attractive, except to his wife.
And often I've been told, not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can always be depended upon. But where is Cecily?
Perhaps she followed.
Mr. Worthing?
We did not expect you till Monday afternoon.
I have returned sooner than expected. Dr. Chorsmore, I hope you are well.
Dear Mr. Worthing, why are you here?
My poor brother Ernest.
More shameful debts and extravagance.
Still leading his life of pleasure?
Dead.
Your brother Ernest? Dead.
Why dead?
Oh, well. What a lesson for him. I trust he'll profit by it.
Dear Mr. Worthing, our most sincere condolence. You have at least the consolation of knowing you were always the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
Poor Ernest. He had many faults, but it's a sad, sad blow.
Very sad indeed. Were you with him at the end?
No, he died abroad in Paris, in fact. I had a telegram last night from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
Was the cause of death mentioned?
A severe chill, it seems.
As a man sows, so shall he be.
Charity, Miss Prism, charity. None of us are perfect. I, myself, am particularly susceptible to rots. Will the interment take place here?
No, he seems to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
In Paris! I fear that Harley wants the very serious state at the last. Would wish me, no doubt, to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction next Sunday.
That reminds me, I suppose you know what a christen already. I mean, you are going to be christened, aren't you?
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in his parish.
But is there an infant in whom you're interested, Mr. Worthing? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried.
Oh, yes.
People who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
But it's not for any child, dear doctor. I'm very fond of children, but the fact is that I would like to be christened myself this afternoon if you have nothing better to do.
But surely, Mr. Worthing, you have been christened already.
Don't remember anything about it.
Have you any great subjects on the...
on the matter? Yeah. Well, I certainly intend to have. Of course, I don't know if I'm too old now, or, I don't know, what I'm wearing is not right.
Not at all. At what hour would you wish the ceremony to be performed?
I might trot around 5 if that would suit you.
Perfectly, perfectly. In fact, I had 2 similar ceremonies to perform at that time. Case of twins occurred recently on the outlying colleges. On your own estate, Paul Jenkins Dakota, the most hard working man.
Don't seem much fun being christened along with other babies. It would be challenged. It would 5:30 be.
Admirably, admirably. And now, dear Mr. Worthing, I will not intrude into a house of sorrow any longer. I would merely beg you not to be too much bowed down by grief. What seem to us bitter trials are often blessings in disguise.
This seems to me to be a blessing of an extremely obvious kind.
Uncle Jack! Oh, I am pleased to see you are back. But what horrid clothes you've got on. Do go and change them.
Cecily!
My child.
What is the matter? Uncle Jack, do look happy. You look as if you had toothache. I've got such a surprise for you. Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother!
are very joyful tidings.
After we had all been resigned to his death, his sudden return seems to me to be particularly distressing.
Brothers in the dining room. Well, I don't know what it all means. I think it's perfectly absurd. Good heaven! Brother John, I have come down from town to tell you.
Associated with Uncle Jack and his philanthropic work. I don't quite like women interested in philanthropic work. So forward of them. Miss Fairfax. Pray let me introduce myself to you. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew? What a very sweet name. Something tells me that we are going to be very great friends. I like her already more than I could say. My first impressions of people are always right.
How nice of you to like me after we've only known each other for such a comparatively short time. Pray sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will always call me Gwendolyn, won't you?
If you wish.
Then it's all quite settled, is it not? A favorable opportunity for my mentioning who I am. My father is Lord Bracknell. You've never heard of Papa, I suppose.
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, Papa, I am glad to say, is entirely unknown. I think it's quite as it should be. So you mind not looking at you through my glasses?
Oh, not for Gwendolyn. Very fond of being looked at.
You're here on a short visit, I suppose.
Oh, no. I live here.
Really? Your mother, no doubt. Or some female relative of advanced years besides her also?
No, I have no mother. Nor, in fact, any relations.
Indeed.
My guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Wedding's ward.
Oh, it is strange he never mentioned to me that he had a word.
How secretive of him.
He grows more interesting hourly. I am not sure, however, that the news inspires me with feelings of a mixed life. I am very fond of you, Cecily. I have liked you ever since I met you. But now that I know that you are Mr. Worthing's ward, I cannot help expressing a wish you were, well, just a little older than you seem to be, and not so alluring in appearance. In fact, if I may speak candidly,
pray do. I feel if anyone has anything unpleasant to say, one should always be quite candid.
Well, to speak with perfect endurance, Cecily, I wish that you were fully 42 and more than usually plain. Ernest has a strong, upright nature. He is the very soul of truth and honor. Disloyalty would be as impossible to him as deception. Even men of the noblest possible moral character are extremely susceptible to the physical charms of others.
I beg your pardon, Gwendolyn, but did you say Ernest?
Yes.
Oh, but it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is my guardian. It is his brother.
Ernest never mentioned to me that he had a brother.
I'm afraid they have not been on good terms for a long while.
Oh, that accounts for it. Of course, you are quite sure that it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be his.
I beg your pardon?
Dear Gwendolyn, different.
Shall I make tea for as usual, miss?
Yes, as usual.
Incredible Cape Cod this is, Miss Cardew.
So glad you like it, Miss Fairfax.
I have no idea there were any flowers in the country.
Flowers are as common here as people are in London.
I don't understand how anybody manages to exist in the country. If anybody who is anybody does. The country would bore me to death.
Very much out to speak the truth. It's the first time in my life that I've ever been reduced to such a position, and I'm quite inexperienced in doing anything of the kind. However, I will inform you that I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all. I've never had a brother in my life, and I don't intend to have one in the future.
No brother at all?
None.
Have you ever a brother of any kind?
Not even the kind.
Well, it is clear that neither of us are engaged to be married to anyone.
It is not a very good place for a young girl to find herself in, is it?
Come, let us go into the house. They were hardly ventured to come after us there.
No, men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This ghastly state of things is what you call bunburying, I suppose.
Yes, and a wonderful, perfectly bunburied tin is the most wonderful bunbury I've ever had in my life. You have no right to bunbury here.
That's absurd. One has the right to bunbury wherever one chooses. Every serious bunbury knows that.
Serious bunburies? Good heavens. Well, I wanted to be engaged to bunbury, that's why. I love her.
I wanted to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
Well, there's certainly no chance of your marrying Miss Cardew.
I don't think there's much likelihood, Jack, of you, Miss Fairfax, being united.
That's no business of yours.
If it was my business, I would have done that. It's very vulgar to talk about one's business.
Can you sit there, calmly eating muffins when we're in the struggle? You seem to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. The butter of public is all over my house. One should always eat muffins quite calmly. It is the only way to eat them.
I say, it's perfectly heartless to eat muffins at all, under the circumstances.
But you have just said it's perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
I told you, I don't want teeth. I suppose a man needs his own tea cakes in his own garden.
You have them. It's quite good.
You know, I've already told you to go.
Well, I haven't finished my dinner yet. No one was having some dinner. Only people like vegetarians do that. Besides, I have just made arrangements with Dr. Trossel to be christened at a quarter to six under the name of Ernest.
The sooner you give up on that nonsense, the better. I've already made arrangements with Dr. Trossel to be christened myself at 5:30, and I will naturally take the name of Ernest, but Gwendolyn would wish it. Besides, I have a perfect right to be christened in my life. No evidence that I've ever been christened at all, and I'd like to think it extremely probable that I never have been, and so has Dr. Trossel. It's entirely different in your case. You've already been christened.
Yes, but I have not been christened for years.
Yes, but you have been christened. That's the important thing.
Quite so. So I know my constitution can stand it. I must say, if you are unsure of ever being christened, I find it dangerous you are venturing on it now. It might make you very unwell. You may hardly forget that someone closely connected with you was nearly taken off, carried off by this week in Paris by a severe chill.
Yes, you yourself said that severe chill was not hereditary.
It used to be, I know. But I dare say it is now. Science is always making wonderful improvements in things.
Again, you're never talking anything but nonsense.
Jack, no more tea for you. Have some tea cake instead. Quite a good thing for you.
I already told you I hate tea cake.
Then why are you allowed to be served up for your guests? What ideas do you have of hospitality?
I have already told you to go. I don't want you here. Why won't you go?
Well, I still have two muffins left. And I still want some tea.
Thank you.
and you think we should forgive them?
Yes. I mean, no.
True. There are things at stake that Brooke cannot surrender. Wish I should tell them. The task is not a pleasant one.
Could we not all speak at the same time?
An excellent idea. I mean, we always speak at the same time as other people. Will you take the count for me?
Certainly.
Your Christian names are still an insuperable error. That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all? Will we be Christian this afternoon?
For my sake, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
I am.
To please me, you already faced this fearful ordeal.
I am.
How absurd to talk about the equality of the sexes. But questions of self-sacrifice are concerned. Men are infinitely beyond us.
We are.
They have moments of physical power in which us women know absolutely nothing.
Darling!
Darling!
Lady Bracknell? Gordon! What does this mean? Merely that I'm engaged to Mr. Worthing, Mama. Come here. Sit down. Sit down immediately. Of course, you will understand that all communications between yourself and my daughter will cease immediately. From this moment, on this point, as indeed on all points, I am firm.
But I'm engaged to be married to Gwendolyn, lady.
You're nothing of the kind, sir. Now, as regards Algernon. Algernon!
Yes, Augusta.
May I ask if it is in this house that your invalid friend Bunbury resides?
Oh, no, Bunbury doesn't live here. Bunbury is somewhere else at present. In fact, Bunbury is dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die? His death must have been extremely sudden.
Oh, he was quite exploded.
Exploded? Was he the victim of a revolutionary outrage? I was not aware that Mr. Bunbury was interested in social legislations. If so, he is well punished for his morbidity.
My dear Augusta, I knew he was found out. The doctors found out that Bunbury cannot live, so that took what I mean. So Bunbury died.
He seems to have great confidence in the opinion of his physician. I am glad, however, that he has made up his mind at last for some definite course of action and acted on the proper medical advice. And now that we've finally gotten rid of this Mr. Bunbury, may I ask, Mr. Worthing, who is that young person whose hand Manifi Algernon is holding seems to me a peculiarly unnecessary manner?
Well, that lady, Miss Bracknell, is Miss Cecily Carty, my ward.
I'm engaged to Cecily, Aunt Augusta.
I beg your pardon.
Mr. Moncrief and I are engaged to be married, Lady Bracknell.
I do not know if there is anything peculiarly exciting in the air in this part of Hertfordshire, but the number of engagements that go on seem to me above the proper average that statistics have laid down for our guidance. I believe some preliminary inquiry on my part would not be put out. Mr. Worthing, is Miss Carter at all connected with any of the larger railway stations in London? I merely desire information. Until yesterday, I had no idea that there were any families or persons whose origin was a terrible.
Miss Carter is the granddaughter of the late Mr. Thomas Carter of 149 Belgrave Square.
That sounds not unsatisfactory.
Extremely kind of you, Lady Bracknell. I have in my possession, you'll be pleased, certificates of Miss Carter's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the means of both the English and German variety.
A life crowded with incident, I see, though somewhat too exciting for a girl her age. I myself am not in favor of premature experiences. Gwendolyn, the time approaches for our departure. We've not a moment to lose. As a matter of form, I'd better ask if Miss Cardew has any little fortune.
About £130,000 in the funds, I believe. Well, that's all. Goodbye, Lady Bracknell. So pleased to have seen you.
A moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000. And in the funds. Miss Cardew seems to me a most attractive young lady now, by the way. Girls of the present day have any solid qualities, any qualities that last and improve over time. We live, I regret to say, in an age of services. Come over here, dear.
Your dress is sadly simple, and your hair seems almost as
in Dracula. This engagement is quite out of the question. I am as guardian's guardian. She may not marry without my consent until she comes of age. That consent I absolutely decline to give.
Onward, Brand. Algernon is an extremely, I may almost say, ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing, but he looks everything. What more can one desire?
Pains me very much to have to speak frankly to you, Lady Brand, about your nephew. The fact is that I do not approve of his moral character. I suspect him of being a truthful.
Truthful?
He obtained admission to my house by the false pretense of being my brother. I turned to assume naming drink. I've just been informed by my maid. An entire pint bottle of wine I was especially reserving for myself. Continuing his disgraceful deception. He continued in the course of the afternoon in alienating the affection of my only ward. Continuing his disgraceful deception, he subsequently stayed to tea and devoured all the muffins. What makes his conduct all the more heartless? He was perfectly well aware from the first that I have no brother. Not at all. Not even of a kind. And I distinctly told him so yesterday afternoon.
Mr. Worthing, I have decided to entirely overlook my nephew's conduct to you.
That's very generous of you, Lady Brown. My decision, however, is unalterable. Decline to give my consent.
Come over here, dear. How old are you?
Well, I'm really only 18, but I always admit to 20 when I go to evening parties.
You're perfectly right in making some slight alteration about your age. A girl should never be quite accurate about her age. It looks so calculating. 18, but admitting to 20 at evening parties. Well, it will not be long until you are of age and free from the restraints of tutelage, so I don't think that your guardian's consent is, after all, a matter of any importance.
Pardon me, Lady Bradford, for interrupting you again. But I think it's only fair to inform you that according to the terms of her grandfather's will, Miss Cardew is not completely of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to me to be a grave objection. 35 is a very attractive age. London society is full of women of the highest birth, who, of their own free choice, have remained 35 for years. I see no reason why our Miss Cecily should not be even still more attractive at the age you mentioned than she is at present.
Algie, could you wait for me till I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You know I could.
Yes, I felt it instinctively. But I couldn't wait all that time. I hate waiting even 5 minutes for anybody. It always makes me rather gross. I'm not punctual myself, I know. But I do like punctuality in others, and waiting, even to be married, quite out of the question.
Then what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrief.
My dear Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states positively that she cannot wait till she is 35, a remark in which I am bound to say seems to show a somewhat impatient nature. I beg of you to reconsider your decision.
My dear Lady Brown, the matter is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolyn, I will most gladly allow your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
You must be quite aware that what you propose is out of the question.
Well, then a passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to.
That is not the destiny I propose for Gwendolyn. Algernon, of course, can choose for himself. Come here. We've already missed 5, if not 6 trains. To miss any more might expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is quite ready for the christenings.
A christening, sir? Is that not somewhat premature?
Both these gentlemen have expressed a desire for immediate baptism.
At their age? The idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. I will not hear of such excesses. Lord Bracknell would be highly displeased if he learned that that was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
Am I to understand that there are 2 he-male christenings this afternoon?
I don't think that that's the thing right now, Dr. Chong.
I grieve to hear such sentiments from you, Miss Worthing. I will return to the church at once. Indeed, I have just been informed by the pew opener that for the last hour and a half, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry.
Miss Prism!
She is the most cultivated of ladies and the very picture of respectability.
It is obviously the same person. May I ask what position she holds in your household?
I am a celibate, madame.
Miss Prison Lady Crackle has been for the last 3 years Miss Carter's esteemed governess and valued companion.
In spite of what I hear of her, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
She approaches. She is now.
I would have told you expected me in the bedroom, dear Canon. I have been waiting there for you for an hour and 3/4. Prism, come here.
Prism, where is that baby? 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house, number 104 Upper Governor Street, in charge of a carriage that contained a baby of the male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the baby carriage was discovered standing by itself in a remote corner of Bayswater. It contained a manuscript of a 3-volume novel with more than revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
I admit with shame, Lady Bracknell,
that I do not know. I only wish I did. The plain facts of the case are these. On the morning of the day that you mentioned, a morning which is forever branded into my memory, I prepared as usual to take the baby out to the carriage. I had also with me a somewhat old but capacious handbag in which I had intended to place the work of a manuscript of art that I had written in my few and occupied hours. Well, in a moment of mental abstraction, for which never can forgive myself, I placed the manuscript in the bassinet, then the baby in the handbag!
Yes, but where did you deposit the handbag?
Do not ask me, Mr. Worthing, I do not know.
Miss Prism, this is of no small importance to me. I insist on knowing where you deposited the handbag that contained that infant.
London.
Which railway station?
Victoria. The Brighton line.
Well, I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolyn, wait here for me.
If you're not too long, I will wait here for you all my life.
What do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I dare not even suspect, Dr. Chasuble. In families of high position, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur. It is hardly considered the thing. Moncrief, and consequently,
knew I had a problem. Why are you so
thank you.